The 50s was the decade that set out to transform Britain.
Oh, life could be a dream if I could take you up in paradise up above.
After the destruction of war, it was time for a fresh start, an age of new idealism and hope for the future. The nation was gripped by an appetite for all things modern and a determination to rebuild the country in a startling new style. And the boldest visions came from the architects. They dreamt up one of the most ambitious, even reckless, experiments in living that this country has ever seen. I'm standing on the roof of one of these utopian dreams, a Park Hill Flats in Sheffield, once one of the most ambitious housing schemes in the world. It's been called the ugliest building in Europe and reviled as a sink estate. But it's post-war architecture like this that's now being saved by English heritage. Love it or hate it, this building is here to stay. After the war, the cities of Britain were grim. Lives were eked out among the rubble of the Blitz. Food rationing was still in place. And thousands who'd been made homeless by the bombs were living in basic prefabs. The most pressing need was for more council homes to tackle the problems of Blitz damage, poverty, and massive overcrowding. In some cities, the working class were still living in a Victorian time warp, in back-to-back slum houses.
Tomorrow is a lovely day.
There are precious few back-to-backs still left, so it's very hard for us to imagine what it must have been like living as a family in two or three rooms, having to bathe in an old tin bath, or go to the outdoor loo in freezing winter. There was no central heating. Tenants were only too eager to move out, and councils happy to oblige. Back in the 1950s, very few people gave two hoots about Victorian buildings like these.
There's an immense job to be done. Talk about slum clearance, for instance. We want to get on with that. But we can't get on with that until we've somewhere to put the people. And so the new housing program is a vital part if we're to make a start. We've got to get a sort of sense of elbow room in order to make a move.
Let's fly way up to the clouds, away from the maddening crowd.
Harold Macmillan pledged to build 300,000 new council homes every year. Money was tight, time was short, and bricks were scarce, so concrete became the new material of choice. The housing crusade was the big opportunity for a group of young, ambitious British architects. This was their chance to import modernism, that fashionable European ideology, and rebuild Britain in its image. They wanted space, they wanted light, they wanted the future to be modern. But they also wanted this new architecture to improve the lot of the masses. This was to be the birth of a new Britain. The Festival of Britain in 1951 had given the public its first taste of this brave new world. But this was really a fantasy version of modernism. It would be the city councils who would convert these ideas into reality. The most pioneering councils were in Sheffield and London. Their public housing would be at the cutting edge. No plan was more radical than the Park Hill estate in Sheffield, one of the biggest public housing estates in the country. It would snake across the hills of Sheffield with four huge concrete blocks of flats housing more than 3,000 people and rising to 13 stories at its highest point. Park Hill was the vision of two young modernist architects, astonishingly both still in their 20s, Jack Lynn and Ivor Smith. They were hired in 1953 and were part of a new breed who believed that architecture had the power to solve society's problems.
It was optimism shared by architects, planners, educationists, health workers, every profession that you could think of. So it was a buoyant, exciting place, exciting time to be doing anything.
I mean, who were your great influences at the time?
Like all the sort of progressive architects who were working around that time, Le Corbusier was our greatest inspiration, not only from what he'd built, but also, and very importantly, from what he'd written. Towards a New Architecture was an inspiring tract. It's a sort of rallying cry to produce something marvellous, and we were caught up in that.
For inspiration, Ivor Smith and the team went to see Le Corbusier's famous apartment block in Marseille, the Unité d'Habitation. The building provided all the services that residents would ever need under one roof. This was Le Corbusier's vision of a healthy, perfect society. The Sheffield team were also inspired by the designs of British architects Alison and Peter Smithson. They'd championed a new style of modernism, brutalism. The name brutalism came from the French for raw, and brutalist buildings had a rough, industrial look. They wanted to expose the structures of their buildings, not conceal them. Decoration was out, concrete was in, and any pretense or artifice was forbidden.
The 50s weren't exactly a time of public consultation. Planners and architects built what they wanted and everybody else had to put up with it. And Park Hill is one big brutalist beast, 1,000 flats sprawled across a Sheffield hillside. Its scale is monumental. Depending on your point of view, this is an act of genius or an act of madness.
One young Sheffield councillor who worked on the Park Hill project in the 50s would go on to become a figure in national politics.
In one sense, we were pioneering to the point of being futuristic. We had some of the amenities of the 21st century, let alone the 20th, but in another sense, we were very traditional. The amenities were modern, but the spirit of the thing, community, families living together, if you like, cheek by jowl, that was the spirit of an earlier age when people wanted to live together.
It was a modern world, but one that was seeking to solve the problems of the old world without losing its values and spirit.
Brutalism was the first modernist architecture to really hark back to the past. Its followers didn't want to ship people out to the suburbs. They wanted to recreate the old slums from within and save some of their best qualities, like the community. I'm walking along one of Park Hill's infamous streets in the sky, all part of this romantic urge. They're even wide enough to take a milkman's float.
The streets in the sky were the most celebrated aspect of the design, allowing residents to walk the entire length of the estate under cover. The block